Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. It's a joy to be here with you and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus. Just a few announcements before we continue our service is, one, it's just an exciting weekend here at Bethany. Last afternoon, I guess, we had a wedding, and then last night we had a baptism, so it's just a joyful time to do ministry here. That's exciting. Also, we have a few weeks till Easter, but before we get to Easter, we're still journeying through Lent. And so in this season of Lent, we have midweek services on Wednesdays. One's at noon, so you can come and worship with our school kids here at Bethany. Then we also have one at 7 o'clock in the evening. But before the 7 o'clock service, you can come and get some food. At 6, that's when dinner starts. So come get some food and then come worship our God together as a community of faith here at Bethany. Also, as we get closer to Easter, our high schoolers this summer, they're going on the trip to LVR, which is in Colorado. And one of the fundraisers that we're going to do for that trip is the Easter breakfast. We haven't done this in a couple of years, but the Easter breakfast on Easter Sunday morning will go 8 to 10 in the morning. There'll be more details about that published as we get closer. But just keep that on your calendar and come Easter morning ready to eat some breakfast and then ready to worship our Lord. Those are all the announcements I have for you this morning. I invite you to rise as we continue to worship our God.
We begin our service in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a baptized servant of the word, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your mercies are new every morning. And though we deserve only punishment, you receive us as your children and provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. Our first reading for this morning is from Isaiah, the 42nd chapter. For a long time I have kept silent. I have been quiet and held myself back. But now, like a woman in childbirth, I cry out, I gasp and pant. I will lay waste the mountains and hills and dry up all their vegetation. I will turn rivers into islands and dry up the pools. I will lead the blind by ways they have not known. Along unfamiliar paths I will guide them. I will turn the darkness into light before them and make the rough places smooth. These are the things I will do. I will not forsake them, but those who trust in idols, who say to images, "You are our gods," will be turned back into utter shame. Hear you deaf, look you blind and see. Who is blind but my servant? And deaf like the messenger I send, who is blind like the one committed to me, blind like the servant of the Lord? You have seen many things, but have paid no attention. Your ears are open, but you hear nothing. It pleases the Lord, for the sake of his righteousness, to make his law great and glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
God's people said.
Amen.
The second reading is Ephesians 5, beginning with the 8th verse. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of the light. The fruit of light consists of goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It's shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for it is light that makes everything visible. This is why it is said, "Wake up, O sleeper! Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's rise for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 9th chapter. As Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And having said these things, he spit on the ground and made mud with the saliva. And then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud and said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others said, "How could a man who is a sinner do such signs?" And there was a division among them. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes?" And he said, "He is a prophet." And they answered him, "You were born in utter sin, and you would teach us?" And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated for the sermon hymn.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. For this blind man, it was an ordinary day as he sat back and listened to all the commotion, all the noises going on around him. This blind man, as he sat back, he heard Esther, someone in the community, talking to her friends about when they were going to go shopping next. This blind man, he sat back and he listened and he heard Levi telling his exaggerated fish stories to all of his friends in the community. This blind man, as he sat and he listened, he heard the clinging and clanging of people throwing coins in the bucket sitting next to him because they felt bad for him. They gave him money out of pity. But on this ordinary day, this blind man, he heard something that he had never heard before. He heard a group of people talking to their rabbi, and they were talking about him. And they said to their rabbi, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man, this blind man, or his parents, that he was born blind?" And this blind man, he heard this, and he got a little upset. They're making judgments about me and about my life. But then this blind man, he heard the rabbi's answer. And the rabbi said, "This man, this blind man, neither nor his parents, but this happened that the work of God might be displayed in him." And this rabbi, he continued, and he said, "While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." This blind man, he heard the rabbi speak, and he had a glimmer of hope, hoping that a work of God might be displayed in his life. And then the rabbi, after he had finished speaking, he stooped down on the ground, he spat on the ground, he made mud with his saliva, and he wiped the mud on the blind man's eyes. And he told him, "Go and wash in the pool of Siloam." And the blind man said, "Well, of course I'm going to wash. You put mud on my face." And as he went to that pool that the rabbi told him to go to, as he put his face in the water to wash his face off, as he rose his face out of the water, something amazing happened. He saw the mud fall off of his eyes. He saw the dirtiness of his hands. He saw the clean, pristine water before him, things that he had never seen before. This once blind man, he can now see. He was once blind, but now he can see. There are a lot of people in our community, in this world, that say, "If I could see it, I'd believe it." There are people who say, "Well, if I lived in the time of Jesus and I saw the miracles that he did, of course I would believe it." There are people who say, "Well, if I was like Thomas and I got to touch the nail-scarred hands of Jesus and got to touch his side where the spear speared him, of course I would believe." There are a lot of people in our world who think seeing is believing. And as they go through life, as they go through difficult times, they cry out to God, "God, give me this miracle. And if you give me this miracle, Lord, I'll believe you in every situation you put me in." Or they go through a painful time or a difficult time, and they cry out to God, "God, give me this miracle, and I'll never doubt you ever again." They say to God, "God, give me this miracle that I'm looking for, and I'll believe you every single time." There are people in our world and our communities who think they need to see something, think they need to look at something in order to believe it. They think they need to see something with their eyes in order to have their faith strengthened in God. But if you notice in John chapter 9, this blind man, there was nothing to see. He couldn't see. He was blind. This blind man, he didn't have all the promises, all the miracles of Jesus to see before him. This blind man, he didn't have his will accomplished because he was still blind. All this blind man had was the words of the rabbi. The words of Jesus. Words like, I am the light of the world. Words like, go and wash in the pool of Siloam. All this blind man had was the word of Jesus. And the word of Jesus for this blind man, it proved to be true. As he went to that pool, he washed, and he could see. In our world today, you and I, we've been given the words of Jesus as well. In the words of Jesus, he reveals who he is, and he reveals what he did for you. And just like with this blind man, the words of Jesus, they always prove to be true. Jesus, he does what he says he's going to do. He says that you're forgiven. You are forgiven through him. He says that you are loved. You are loved through Jesus. He says that you are saved. You are saved because of your Lord and Savior, Jesus. The words of Jesus, they're something to rely on. And there's something to cling to. Because Jesus, he always does what he says he's going to do. You and I, just like this blind man, have been given the words of Jesus. Well, the people in the community, they saw this changed blind man that he could see. And they noticed something was different. And the community, they were divided. Some of the people in the community said, is this the blind man who was just sitting on the street corner earlier last week and begging for money? Is this the same man? And some said, of course it is. And others said, no way, it can't be this blind man because he's walking around and he looks different. And the people, they were torn because they saw this once blind man walking around with hope like he had never had before. He was walking around like someone who had burdens lifted off of his shoulders. And this torn community, they said, I know what we'll do. We'll bring him to the religious leaders of the day, and they'll give us the answer. We'll bring him to the Pharisees. And they brought this former blind man to the Pharisees. And the blind man, he told them the story of what happened. The rabbi came. He spit in the mud. He put mud on my eyes, and now I could see. And the Pharisees, as they heard the story, they were divided. Some said, this rabbi, he can't be from God because he broke the Sabbath laws. Other Pharisees said, well, a sinner can't do the mighty works of God that this blind man is describing. And the Pharisees, they were divided. And so they finally said to this blind man, well, you were healed by him. You were blind and now you can see. What do you think? What do you have to say about this rabbi? Is this man a prophet of God? Is he from God? Or is this man a sinner? And this once blind man, he declared boldly about the rabbi, this man is a prophet. I was driving in my car the other day in an unfamiliar part of Kansas City, a place I had never really been before. And as I was driving and driving, I was thinking about all the different things that I had to get done throughout the week. And as I was driving and thinking, I also was beating my thumb on the steering wheel and jamming out to the music that was blasting on the radio. And as I was thinking and jamming out to the music in my car, I was also looking at all the different restaurants and shops and said, well, I have to try that one, or I have to go eat there. I have to go experience that store and buy something there. And as I was driving and thinking and jamming and talking and thinking about all the different restaurants and stores, my GPS said those words that you never want to hear. Rerouting, rerouting, rerouting. I was so focused on other things that I missed the turn to get to my destination. If we don't know what to look for, if we don't know what to focus on, there's a chance that you'll miss it. The Pharisees in our text in John chapter 9, They had an obvious sign of Jesus. A once blind man could see, and this once blind man that could see was standing right before them, and he told them exactly what happened. And this obvious sign standing before the Pharisees, they missed it. They missed it because they were focused on other things. Well, this man can't be from God because he broke the Sabbath laws. Is this man a prophet or is he a sinner? The Pharisees are so focused on their legalism that they missed out on this obvious sign of Jesus. The prophet Isaiah, he talks about works that the Messiah was going to do, like opening the eyes of the blind, setting the captives free, preaching good news to the poor, proclaiming the year of the Lord's favor. And there was an obvious sign, and the Pharisees missed it because they were focused on other things. In our lives, there are things that try to pull and grab our attention in different areas and pull it away from Jesus. There are times in our lives where we tend to focus on the lies that Satan tells us about our sins or about our sinful past, and we focus on those instead of focusing on the words of life and forgiveness that Jesus Christ says to you. There are times in our lives as we go through difficult and painful things, and in the midst of that pain, we tend to focus on the pain and the words of comfort, the words of hope, the words of peace that Jesus has for us. They come and they go out of focus. There are times in our lives when we try to live according to who we think we are instead of living who Jesus has declared us to be. And Jesus, he goes out of focus. Throughout this Lenten season, as we get closer and closer to Easter, I want to encourage you to fix your spiritual eyesight, to focus in on Jesus. Focus in on who he's revealed himself to be. And the way to focus in on Jesus is by spending time in his word. Spending time in his word where he reveals fully who he is for you. That he's your savior. That he's the one sent to come and take your sins away. That he's the one, because of his work on the cross and because he rose from the grave, he's the one who has given you life. Life in God's name. So I encourage you this Lenten season, as we get closer to Easter, cling to the words of Jesus. Focus in on the words of Jesus, where he reveals fully who he is for you and who you are because of his work on the cross and because that Easter morning, as he rose from the grave, defeating death and sin and Satan for you. Well, the Pharisees, they didn't like the blind man's testimony about this prophet. He said that he was a prophet, and they didn't like that, so they cast him out of their presence. And this blind man, there he was, sitting isolated, cast off from everybody else, just like he was at the beginning of the story. But this time he was isolated and cast off, not because of his blindness, but because of his testimony about this man who healed him. And in the midst of his isolation, as he was cast off from the Pharisees, a stranger, a man that he had never seen before, came up to this former blind man. And he asked him a pretty direct question. He asked him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And the blind man, he responded by saying, "Where is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" And this rabbi, who we know to be Jesus, he said to this blind man, "You have seen him. It is he who is speaking to you." And this former blind man, he got on his knees and he worshiped Jesus because his Savior was there, standing right before him, and he could see clearly for the first time who his Savior is. The journey that this blind man goes through in John chapter 9, it's similar to our faith journey here on earth as well. Just like this blind man at the beginning of the story, we don't have the luxury of seeing Jesus face to face. We don't have the luxury of interacting with Jesus like we do our family and our friends in an earthly way. Just like this blind man at the beginning of the story, all we have are the words of Jesus. The words of Jesus where he reveals who he is, your Savior, the one who came to this world for you, the one who has given you eternal life because of his work on the cross and in the grave as he rose from the dead. But just like this blind man, one day, because of the words of Jesus that create faith in us, one day we will see Jesus face to face. And one day, as Jesus is standing there before you, he'll say to you, "You have seen him. It is he who is speaking to you." And now may the grace of God, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, may it guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. We now continue our service by joining our voices together as we sing. Please rise as we confess our Christian faith together using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit from the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand.
We pray. Gracious Lord, this is the day you have made. Help us rejoice and be glad in it. And rejoice with those who today celebrate that moment that you made a choice to include them in your family, adopt them into your household, bathe them in the blood of Jesus Christ, robe them in the righteousness of your Son, and write their names in the book of life in the waters of baptism. With Allie, Alice, Melina, Ava, Alex, Anna, Patty, Carla, Lena, Kristen, Brent, Ruth, and Jim. We thank you today for declaring them holy and precious in your sight, and removing from them as far as the east is from the west their sins, and setting them upon the pathway of righteousness by depositing in their hearts your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy. Father, with the weeks that lie ahead of us leading up to Easter, help us to maximize the opportunities before us to seek first your kingdom of God, to rend our hearts, not our garments, and to set our face like flint toward an empty cross and an empty tomb. And during this Lenten season, Lord, to discover again the heights, the depths, and the breadths of your love for us in Jesus Christ, and the enormity of the weight that he bore, our sins and our transgressions upon the cross, making the celebration of Easter even more sweet. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we ask you to bless Austin and Courtney as they were united yesterday in this sanctuary and holy matrimony. Help them to love as you have first loved them. Help them to forgive as you have freely forgiven them. And make them examples of righteousness to all they encounter. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for our partnership with Emmanuel, their outreach in their community, and the opportunity we have to bring the word of good news to a world living in darkness. Open their mouths and help them declare your praises. And open the ears of those who are told, that they might hear, that they might believe, and that they might respond by joining us in a common confession of a one true faith, one hope, and one Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who are struggling with their health, those in need of healing. Create in them new hearts and right spirits. And if it's your will to restore what is broken and diseased and damaged, to you be all the glory. Today we're praying for Michael and Ilsa and Maurice and John, Janine, Donald and Matt. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who are anticipating the birth of children. We pray for these couples, particularly these moms and their unborn son or daughter. We pray, a hedge of protection around them, that you would drive the evil one far from them. And when that anticipated day arrives, bring these children before you. And in your presence, declare them righteous and holy in your sight, setting them aside, precious and holy and beloved and peculiar before you, naming them as your own sons and daughters, and in the waters of baptism, washing away all of their sins. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who's taught us that prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into I'm going to shift you down into Granny right now, because since the first of the year, we have been introducing you a new order of service, Divine Service 2, but we've never done the communion liturgy, and the tones are a bit different. So if you'd open up your hymnal to page 177, so those of you that can watch the notes will be able to do that. And Hick Young, if you can just play the right hand, just give us the melody, I think we'll be much better off. Thank you very much. Page 177, the preface. Everybody ready? Let's give it a try. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Father, Almighty God, ever-living Lord. So with the angels and the archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your name, evermore praising you and singing. You have had mercy on those you've created. You sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin, to be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and in the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive and renew and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us to do in his own testament. And gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone be, O Father, be all glory and honor and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to him, saying, "Drink you all of it, for this is the cup in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Drink of this often in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord be with you always."
Thank you.
Please rise. And now that you receive the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of all your sins, may it strengthen and preserve you, both in body and soul, until life everlasting. Depart in our Savior's peace. Amen. We sing. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on that day of his coming, we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear the blessing of the Lord to you from Numbers chapter 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.